Hi, I'm Andrea Hewlin. I'm a visual art teacher here at TAFE Queensland. I have more than 10 years industry experience, and today I'm going to show you some basics for sketchbook drawing. So pretty much all you need for drawing at home or wherever you are is some paper and a pencil. So you don't need to be put off by the fact that you might not have expensive or high-tech drawing equipment. Anything will do pretty much. But what's preferable is to have pages that are blank. Although if you're like me, you might have diaries left over from various years where, you know, there are lined pages or calendars that you've filled out until about March before you've lost interest and they're empty and lying around. You can just pick those up and use those to draw in as well. And sometimes the lines and other little scratches or scribbles in your various notebooks that are lying around can add a bit of interest and texture to your drawings as well. Your paper can be just a loose sheet of paper like this, or it can be in a little book like this. And of course, sketchbooks can be various different sizes. You can have tiny little weeny ones like this. And as you can see, I'm a little bit of a collector of sketchbooks. Or you can have some big pads like this. So pretty much it's whatever you want to draw in and whatever you might have around at home. So I guess the first thing is, why draw? Why sit and do a drawing when you can take a photo? Obviously you might want to improve your skills at drawing, get better at it, but even then it's why sit or take a sketchbook with you in your handbag when you've got your phone with you and you can take a photo? Well, I think that drawing allows you to do some pretty special things. For a start, if you stop and get out your pencil and your book, you're really in your surroundings. You're really looking and experiencing where you are for that period of time. You're really taking the time to stop and actually assess and look at what you're about to draw. And it's a really great way of sort of being in that space and taking your time to look and focusing in on it. The other really nice thing about sketchbooks and taking them with you when you travel or when you're out and about or even just in the house for any period of time is that you will go back over it later and you'll look and you won't only remember the scene, but you'll remember how you felt when you did the drawing. So you might want to add a bit of text, a date or something that reminds you of that scene. But when you look back at them, you will sort of, you'll remember where you sat and how it felt and what the weather was like. And there's something pretty great about that, even if the drawing is not the best drawing that you will ever see in your life. So to me, that's why it's great to draw, and it's why it's really fun to have a sketchbook with you. It's all very well to draw, but it's not much fun or very satisfying if you don't have any skills or technique. So I'm going to show you a few basic skills and some techniques that will make your drawing in your book or wherever you decide to draw a little bit more satisfying and rewarding. Okay, so now we're going to do some drawing, and I've set up this little arrangement with vases and some things like you might have at home. My suggestion would be, don't overthink it, come up with something that's fairly simple. Better to draw something than to wait for the perfect inspiration. So the more you draw, the more practiced you'll get, the more fun it'll be for you. So I'm just using an HB pencil, which is sort of somewhere between a hard and a soft pencil, and H pencils you'll see are the hard light ones, and B pencils are the ones that are softer and darker. So I would suggest something like an HB for your light marks and a 2B for your darker marks, or you could just press harder with either. You'll also need an eraser. I don't use an eraser too much because I like all the sort of sketchy construction lines to show, but if you want to, any kind of eraser is good as well. And also a knife like this for sharpening your pencil so that you get a nice long section of graphite to draw with. So before we even start, it's a good idea to just practice with your pencil a little bit and just get the feeling of how to hold it. So when you're writing, you hold a pencil down quite low like this and you've got quite a lot of control, but you also don't have much hand movement. So why don't you try holding your pencil down a little bit further like this and a little bit more softly so that you're able to sort of move it around a bit, try different holds and experiment with some different pressures. So for example, like I've done over here, you can try just making some marks on your page, just scribbling marks, light marks, circles, flicks, little crosshatchy type marks. Try the edge of the pencil, try the point of the pencil, and just see what kind of marks and how dark and light you can get your particular tool. So that's a good place to start. Now let's draw our object. So the first thing I'm going to do is, with my lighter pencil, is just to create some really light, what we call construction lines. So they help us to measure and to get some marks down about the relationship between things before we kind of commit to making some hard, darkish marks. So hopefully you can see this on the page, but I'm going to be working quite lightly. And first, I'm just going to get a bit of a sense of the overall composition on the page. So if I squint my eyes, I can see that these objects form a bit of a triangle on the surface there. So I'm going to pretty much, to start with, just kind of throw a blanket over them and think about what the shape looks like of all of those objects together. And it's pretty much like that. So now that I've done that, I'm going to start to build in the individual objects. So this is like a kind of a cylinder that comes down here, and then it flares out at the bottom. Not really committing to any marks yet. I'm just kind of working out where everything is. I don't want to start perfectly over here with my lemon and then find that once I've gone over here, I've got everything completely out of proportion and I've wasted all that time. So this is a way of just quickly sketching everything out, working out where things will go. And I've already seen I've got a bit of a problem here. So that lemon needs to come further out. Bottom of the jug, this jug here. So think about negative spaces as well. So what does the shape look like between these two objects? And that'll help you to work out how far away they are and what the right shape of their edges is. So likewise here, this jug comes in about here. There. So see, my marks are quite scribbly and I'm correcting as I go, but not committing. Squinting my eyes just to make sure I'm not getting bogged down in detail. I'm just thinking about overall shapes. I'm going to end up very wrinkled. Okay, so at this stage, if I want to, just to keep things clear for me, I can rub out some of those construction lines, but generally I'm quite happy to keep them there because out of all of those lines, one of them's right, you know? So I can just accentuate that one when I come in to put in some darker marks. So it's quite important to sort of think about the kind of energy of a particular object. By that I mean, what's its jugness? What's the juggy thing about it? And with this one, it's that it's got a plump middle section. It's got sort of these nice little shoulders here. So I want to try and get them right. And same with this, the big black vase, it kind of has a bit that bulges out, that kind of comes out here in this nice shape. So I want to try and get that right. So think about what it is about the particular object or thing that makes it that thing, and kind of make sure you accentuate that a little bit. Okay, so now once I've got to the point where I've got everything pretty much, I think, where it should be in relationship to each other, to the other objects and so on, now I can start to move in with some darker marks. So now I'm going to my 2B pencil, but if you're just using the one pencil too, you can just start to press a little bit harder. So I'm not going to outline everything with a really dark shape, because things don't have outlines around them really. They only have dark lines where they're in shadow or where they're meeting up against each other. So I'm just going to find now, by squinting my eyes, where the dark parts of this image are. And I can see that there are some dark bits around the rim here. I'll make this section here a bit of a dark line. Bring out that nice little shoulder. And where objects meet the ground, or the surface, is quite important to give them a little shadow so that the objects don't look like they're floating. You'll notice that I'm keeping those curved. We don't want flat bottoms. So I've pretty much just picked up the bottoms of those objects, starting to develop a little bit of a sense of dark and light. Okay, so I'm not going to put a dark outline around it, everything, as I said. Maybe just a little one there. Okay, so my drawing's taking shape, but how do I make it look three-dimensional on the page? How do I stop it from just looking like outlines, you know, on a white background? Well, that's where we shade or add tone. So tone is really just a way of going from, or a way of describing lights and darks. So you can create lights and darks in lots of different ways in drawing. There's the good old traditional sort of shading where you put your pencil lightly on its side and you just create a kind of a tone like this, going from dark to light. It's very sort of smooth. You can even smudge it with your finger. Or you can do a bit of a hatch like this. Or a cross hatch. Closer together they are, and the darker you press, the darker a tone you'll have. The further apart they are and the lighter you press, the lighter an area of tone you'll have. It's a little bit more time consuming. I'm a bit of a fan of your scribble. Quick and easy, quite satisfying. But you could also do circles, you know, you could do anything close together, press darkly, further apart, pressing lightly will help you go from dark to light. So it's a matter of just applying that technique of shading, whatever you choose, to your object. So I can see that my vase in the background here is black. So I'm going to give it an all-over tone, an all-over dark tone to start. So I'm just going to give it a bit of a scribble. I'm not going to worry about going over the edges too much because it's just a sketch. So while I'm here, I'll look for other areas that are a little bit darker, a sort of a mid-tone within my image. And there's a little bit of the lemon here that's darkish. I might take this chance to put my shadows in. So remember, we're talking about sketchbook drawing here, so we're talking about techniques for drawing things fairly quickly and getting the essence of things down without necessarily making a masterpiece. So, you know, you might, if it was objects you were drawing of your own breakfast table, for example, you might like to just focus in on one part of it, like to have this background just an outline, but to really do some shading and have this front part look nice and then leave it at that. Or you might take a photo and come back to it later and really refine it. But It doesn't have to be an all over, every image in your sketchbook doesn't have to be a all over perfectly finished drawing. So now I've started that sort of shading process there by squinting my eyes and seeing where the darks and lights are. The important thing with drawing and shading especially is to draw what we actually see, not what we think we see or not what we remember. And that's why it's important to look and draw at the same time. So you're looking at your page and you're also looking at the object or the person just by flicking your eyes. If you have to turn and look over your shoulder back to the object, then you're relying on your memory, not what you can actually see. And that way you'll make some mistakes because you're saying, oh, I know what a jug looks like. I remember what a jug looks like. You're not actually drawing where the shadows are and where their lines are. So anyway, this is just going to be a little quick example, but you can see now that I've put in some tone, I can build up tone by pressing harder and maybe adding a different kind of mark. So now that I've got these lines going this way, I might bring in the darker side of the jug with a line going this way. So do you see how gradually we've built in from those initial construction lines we made? We're starting to add a little bit of tone, and just as we go, we're building in bits and pieces of detail. We're not starting in one particular part of the drawing and making it all perfect before we move on to the next. Other ways that you can create tone are to use a water-soluble pencil, for example, like this one here. If I just create my jug again over here. I could do a little bit of shading down that side. Create this little jug here. Seem to have lost my paintbrush. I'll just use my finger. And we can create a little bit of tone that way. You can also use coffee. You could make a wash with really dark coffee. Not any coffee with milk in it, and you could use that to shade in areas of tone instead of doing the drawings as well. And that can really be quite satisfying because it gives a nice sepia tone as well. So just a really quick example there of how a drawing can be built up from those really sketchy light lines to something that starts to resemble a drawing. So while I'm here, I'd like to just show you a couple of little traps and things that are common mistakes that we make when we're drawing. So the first one, which is a common mistake or a common issue when you're drawing, are ellipses. And if you're drawing something from home on the breakfast table or anything, you're probably likely to come across an ellipse. These can be tricky, and for some reason we find ourselves making them bigger than they should be. I think it's just tempting. We say our minds say to us, oh yes, there's a circle at the top of that cup. I know it's a circle, so it must be, you know, like this. A really good trick to help you with things like this or anything where you're concerned about proportion is to actually measure what this actual distance is in comparison to this distance here. So to help you do that, you can actually look at the object with your pencil and say, if I was to take that section there and then count how many there are in the cup, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I need another 6 of those within that cup, if you know what I mean. So that can help you to actually realize how narrow that is, rather than being so broad like that. The same thing applies with people. So with people, there are actually 7.5 heads in a person. So this distance here, let's see if I've got it right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.5. Oh. So that can help you get proportions right with people, is just to kind of do that measuring thing. Well, how many heads are there between here and his waist belt? How many heads are there between here and the feet? So if you're constantly doing this little measuring, also looking at angles. So if I had an apple sitting over here as well, and I wanted to work out the distance between here, here and here, you know, you can actually sort of say to yourself, well, how far off the horizon is it? How far does it dip down? Ask yourself about some angles between things. What's this angle here? What's this, you know, especially if you're dealing with straight things. You know, what's this angle on the side of this jug here? How far off the vertical is it? So anyone can draw if you're able to observe and measure and assess. Think of angles of things like this too as hands of a clock. You know, you could say to yourself, what's the angle of that foot here? Well, it's, you know, 25.2. So however it makes sense to you, is those little tricks can really help you when you're drawing. Another common mistake are the flat bottoms. So we've got our cup here with this particular circular shape here, semicircle here, but then we give it a flat bottom. This line here matches this line here, it has to match. So make sure you give the bottoms of things a nice curve too. And we talked about how to place things on a page by pretending that we're kind of throwing a blanket over them and creating their overall shape. Another common mistake when we don't do that is running out of space. So our object is here, our thing there, and then oops, we've run out of space to put our apple. Or our person is here, and by the time we get to the feet, we realize that we've run out of page. So by planning it beforehand, by doing a little quick sketch of where everything is placed, you'll avoid that problem. So we've talked about why we draw and how it's fun to have a sketchbook with us, because it helps us to capture more than just the scene. It helps us to capture a little bit about the feeling that came with it when we were there, and also some memories that came with you actually, or us being in that position at that time. It's fun, and it gives another dimension to any outing or any activity that you're doing. We've talked about how it's important to squint your eyes and to look at the overall shape of things rather than to get too bogged down on details, and also how we draw what we see, not what we remember seeing or what we think we see, and that way we're much more likely to have some success in looking fairly realistic. The big message I'd like to get across today is, yes, you can draw. You just need to be able to take your time and to be able to measure and assess and correct and think and really analyze a little bit what you are seeing, and be confident to just pop it down. Not to worry too much about your drawings being absolutely perfect. Think of them more as being a little visual record and have some fun with it. You don't need fancy equipment. You just need a pen and paper, pencil and paper. So thanks a lot for joining me today. If you'd like to learn more about studying visual art at TAFE Queensland, then please go to our website, tafeqld.edu.au.